It's totally Tom and Tully. We've got the SCL match number two coming at you. SCL, fun stuff going on. Elevate, they just won 2-0, which means their land dreams are still alive, but we'll put a hold on that as Eager plays next. For now, it's all about Soar and Kingdom.
Soar currently 9-5 in their standings, and they have a realistic chance of making the land if they win out the rest of the split.
And they don't actually have to win out the rest of the split. They've got a little bit of wiggle room, right?
They do have a little bit of wiggle room, but if they do win out, then there's no chances of anyone knocking them out because their last match would be against Eager, which is the team they're trying to overtake, and that would give Soar the head-to-head record and allow them to overtake that number two seed.
Soar, unfortunately, are going to have a struggle as they do that because they will drop one game. Game number one of this set will be forfeited. Unfortunately, the team was unable to find a competitive roster, so Kingdom will get the win for game number one. Soar was able to lock down all five members of their team, however, coming into this one, and they will be able to continue for game number two. It should be all five starters, so nothing crazy. You want to blame Chapo?
I don't know who I would blame in this situation.
I think Chapo might beat me up, so I'm not going to blame Chapo. Either way, this team unfortunately could not get things rolling for game number one, but game number two certainly going to come at you very, very strong. These guys, Soar, have looked strong all season. They've really put their work in, and you can watch in their gameplay. And this is one of those things that don't make it to the scoreboard. You can't really like quantify this, but I feel like Soar wins harder than the other teams, despite not being number one.
They make the aggressive plays all the time. Mm-hmm. Chapo loves to make the aggressive plays, and then Aggro always trying to bail him out whenever he just oversteps just a little bit too much. And then from there, yeah, bro, Chacho making rotations as well, just playing aggressive Guardian supports, whether it's the Bacchus or the Ares, just looking for that kind of aggression that Soar's known to make. And then they always find the objectives afterwards, which is the most important thing.
I think these guys play just so cohesive. Their brand of smite is just put together so well, and everybody able to, like you said, I mean, you get hyper aggression out of Chapo, and then you get the reeling of it in from the mid laner Aggro, which is kind of funny how their names work. And then Bro Chacho, on the other hand, he's always just sort of that diamond in the rough that's going to help out wherever it's needed. So that allows his team Soar, not Elevate, to really make things happen and look very strong. We'll come right back here real quick as we get things in order. I mean, if my hair is going to be messed up, the picks and bans might as well be messed up as well, right?
And Soar, the way they play together, they reflect on it on their scoreboard. Like, because they're so aggressive together as a team, their kill participation to combined is around 75% or so in that little margin area. And that's why they've been so successful, because they're always grouped up and you can't find anybody isolated away from Soar and find a pick.
Exactly. And now I'm not saying that this is I don't want to get myself into trouble and make this analogy, but it's similar to when you watch Panthera play, right? I'm not saying Soar plays at the level that Panthera does just yet. Who knows what the future holds? But that's what has made Panthera so successful on the PC side of things, where there is never a situation where somebody is out of range of help. And that's what you see out of Soar. Very rarely is somebody completely isolated where they can't get follow-up help from jungle, mid, support, solo, etc.
You can't isolate them because they're the ones that are coming at you, honestly.
Yep.
it's just like, you see the train coming, like, what do you really do in this situation?
You just sort of wait and play chicken best you can. Kingdom Esports going to ban out the Guan Yu, very intelligent choice, whereas Soar bans out Kabrakin.
Just typical bans so far compared to the last set that we saw. Guan Yu, Ao Kuang being banned, Nemesis Kabrakin on the side of Soar, so early on ban for the Nemesis, not that banned very often with only 16%, but this leaves a decent amount of options for Kingdom, but going to elect to take Thor away from Chapo.
Yeah, it's a good selection. Kingdom going to give T-Small their Thor. And I mean, Thor in general, whether it's taking it away from Chapo, we see this all the time. Are you really taking it away from a strong player, or do you just want a Thor? Because he has so many different gameplay styles, so many different ways to play the game. We mentioned ambiguity a lot by way of picks. You see a Neith, is she going to be mid or long lane? Where is she going to go? Thor is ambiguous because it doesn't reveal your hand what gameplay style you want to play. You know he's in the jungle, but is he set up defense, etc.?
I mean, we could see him in the solo, possibly.
All right, totally.
We haven't seen him in a while in the solo, and so I kind of miss that a lot. I have a lot of fun playing Thor in the solo, but either way, Soar going to take the Ryzen and the Robin, so setting themselves up for the jungle pick later on is nice because you know that that Kingdom more than likely are putting that Thor in the jungle position and capitalizing right away with more globals, going to take the Athena.
And, you know, this is one of the benefits. Chapo has an extremely large god pool, and that's one of the benefits of having a player with a big god pool is the fact that, all right, well, they ban out on Kwong. We're going to ban out some junglers. You can pick Thor. And if it gets down to it, Chapo, he'll play whatever you want. So it allows you to go ahead and prioritize some of the other picks instead of saying, all right, there's a lot off the board. I need my Awilish ready, set, go. Because I expect Awilish to be banned here by Kingdom immediately.
Chapo known to play Awilish because he likes to be aggressive, and that is a great god in the early game paired up with the Robin. We saw the Awilish Robin combo the last set, game number two. Very deadly combination, especially the fact that the Awilish could pull Scylla away during the Sentinel because it is considered a jump even though it is going underground.
Yep, same thing with the Hades dash. You can pull that out of the air as well. Both of them count. Second ban coming out for Kingdom. Like I said, I definitely expect this to be an Awilish. I'll be surprised and a little bit let down if Kingdom go in a different direction.
Just waiting on this last ban. Going to be the Susanoo. So they are playing chicken with Sora. They're saying, okay, take the Awilish. We don't want to deal with Susanoo because the mobility and the setup that Susanoo brings is really strong as well, because there's more flexibility with Susanoo, where if you get behind early on as Susanoo, it's not the end of the world, but if you get early behind as Awilish, it's a little bit more difficult to find the engagements.
I can hear Chapo laughing. Chapo, I mean, so Chapo's been a longtime streamer on Twitch, and now he's really starting to get into the YouTube game, not just with gameplay, but also workout videos too. Kudos to him, but I could just hear that Chapo laugh like, okay, Poppy, you want me to play Awilish? I will. So he selects the Awilish. It's going to go hand in hand with the nonsense of Scylla, like we were talking about. But Kingdom play it smart. Sobek and Rom, neither of these characters are going to leave the ground on their own accord. So there's not a lot for Kingdom to hand the Scylla. And that's going to be turned around by Sor, the selection of Sylvanas by Brochacho. You're going to force a couple of players into the air. But we also saw this before. We saw this last week from Brochacho, the only person to bring him out. And it was a win.
Exactly. We looked at the numbers on the right-hand side. Mm-hmm. Only picked once, and that was from Brochacho finding the win. He's known to play this little bit of a mixture between aggressive, but he knows how to pull it back by picking this Sylvanas, which will allow himself to protect the mid to late game in Shibalanke. So what he's trying to do is make sure that there's no sort of early game aggression coming out of the Sobek Rom in the dual lane. You're going to have the sustain necessary. Sylvanas, the root recently, once the flower comes out, you have more MP5 now, so which is going to allow Shibalanke to stay in the lane longer and look for just more plays potentially around that Gold Fury.
So that Sobek is going to be a solo Sobek, most likely. The Athena can also play solo, but I think that's a little bit more flavorful, right?
It depends what you're trying to get out of it. Now, Athena can do a double rotation where she can either use her ultimate to rotate or use a teleport to rotate, which would allow her to be more useful in that earlier engagement, especially considering you will be a higher level. It's a little bit easier to clear in the early laning phase as Athena in the solo lane as well, because what you do is you dash through the wave, you use your reach to hit the enemy solo laner, so you bunch up the wave by the archers, and then you drop your shield wall immediately in that circle, whereas Sobek earlier on struggles for the clear.
So if you're looking at the matchup both matchups, you got to take into account. You're looking at the long lane matchup, right? It's either Athena Rom or Sobek and Rom versus the Shibalanke and Sylvanas. Who would you rather have in support?
For the Rom?
To
protect myself, I would rather have Sobek because the tail flip displacement and the lurking in the water would slow during the engagement, whereas the Athena ultimate would mitigate a little bit of damage, but you're still going to get aggressed on, and the Sobek could buy you time with that slow, potentially.
Well, it's going to be Nykwid playing the Sobek into the short lane, and, you know, I'm excited about that because, one, I mean, it's Sobek. That's my lifeblood. That's one of my favorites. It's the summer of Sobek 16 and Nykwid last week. Solo Sobek can be very scary, and I'm going to ask you to elaborate on that in a little bit. But Nykwid himself, he's newer to this roster. Kingdom doing the same thing that we saw out of Noble, switching some things around, trying new players, certainly looking towards the future. Nykwid was very strong last week. We got to see him pull a lot of fun stuff on the Sobek out. So, I mean, what makes Sobek solo so dominant?
when you transition away from that early laning phase into team fights, once you get the Breastplate of Valor online, you're going to have a lot of cooldowns necessary to get the tail flips, be a great displacement god to get everybody out of position, trying to charge prey somebody into your team, as well as having the Athena and the Sobek. Those are two great initiation tools for Kingdom to possibly find somebody from Sort out of position.
One of the fun things about Sobek is that he deals a lot of damage, but like all Guardians, it's on his base. It's on his base damage, not necessarily by way of itemization or anything. But so by putting the character in the solo lane by himself, he's able to get a lot of experience and then build those levels up.
And we didn't talk about this before, but the Sobek did start the Wrath, trying to get the speed and the blue buff quickly enough to get into the laning phase, not losing out too much gold or experience under that tower. Whereas it looks like Sword was able to get those Fire Giant elementals on the side of Chapo and aggro.
With that said, it was a big part of what just happened was that the Thor didn't go to the solo lane at all. Thor immediately after buffs went right to mid camps, and that allowed him to go ahead and pick up the Harpies. So a little bit of a small, slightly different strategy, just enough to shake things up.
So the Sylvanas already doing its worth by just constantly sustaining the Shibalanke. The early laning phase is going to be a little difficult for Shibalanke, but once it gets to like about level 6 or 7, that's when he's going to start to clear pretty efficiently, and the Sylvanas will allow him to stay in the laning phase basically forever.
I mean, basically for the guys on Sor, I mean, this is... Keegs is not looking to be aggressive. Keegs and Brochacho are just looking to tread water right now until everything starts to get a little bit more fancy, whereas Sor on the right side of the map, quite the opposite. They're looking to be very aggressive, and you can already see aggro and Chapo combining to steal back Harpies.
And we saw the last week where Sor took on Noble. Keegs May was the MVP for week number 5.
Oh,
aggro going to actually barely escape from the aggression.
Kata.
The Sentinel trying to find the kill, but Catalyst might have overstepped his boundaries.
But Thor is here, and there's a quick, beautiful purification by Brownside, reading the attack from the jungler, and he's going to get on out of there. That right there, that's a highlight play going the way of Sor, unless Brownside hits that exact purification. And that has to happen before the Feather Step comes through. Beautiful read coming out of Brownside in his second play, or his second time here on the SCL stage. Love that play. Wow.
Normally, we don't see this kind of plays coming out. Sor being the ones to be first-blooded. Chapo forced to use Purification with that nice rotation from Reacher, trying to make the counter-aggressive play with the knock-up, not going to be able to find it. And we were talking about the style earlier on from Sor, the way they're aggressive in the mid-jungle combination, whereas Keegs is more passive. The last week, when Sor took on Noble, Keegs May was very quiet in both games early on, but then once teamfights started happening, he transitioned very efficiently, and that's why he got MVP.
Look at this early Gold Fury attempt. Already down to about 90%. Pushing it further now that mid lane and jungle have joined. Half HP on the Gold Fury already. Kingdom have no idea. The ultimates are coming out, and that's going to be a free Gold Fury going the way of Sor. So they drop first blood immediately, look towards objectives, and they find themselves up by 500 gold.
It's not too much at this stage of the game, but they're not losing any objectives, which is important. They're not losing the Gold Fury because Sobek has Wrath. If he makes the rotation, that could be a free Gold Fury for Kingdom. And in response, they're not losing any of their buffs on their side of the jungle as well, despite getting first blooded.
Right. And, you know, the 500 gold lead isn't important. It's the fact that they were down 500 gold from the first blood. That's why I bring up the fact that they're up 500, because of that huge swing that the objective gives them. And like I said, Kingdom had no clue.
No clue whatsoever. The wards
they
did
still
fizzle
no
away.
Clue.
It's like, it's coming up to that 4 minute mark where the wards fizzle away from the earlier on level one positioning where you're trying to group up, look for the wards because you're afraid of getting invaded on. Those wards don't last forever. And the timing of it by Sor was executed just perfectly.
Earlier in the day, we saw a couple of opportunities dropped because players mistimed their ganks. We saw a couple of ganks in the solo lane that were unable to be capitalized off of because it was in between the spawning of the buffs in the enemy jungle. And these are the things that we don't really talk a lot about on broadcast because they're so small and they're so minute, but that's what separates a top level team like Sor from some of the other guys in the league. The minute count actually really matters. And if that Gold Fury gets taken 30 minutes sooner, or 30 seconds sooner, or 30 seconds later, when Kingdom's able to drop a ward down, it doesn't go down for free, if at all.
And sometimes you just got to take them as they come. So Kingdom getting the first blood onto aggro was, even though they didn't get anything off of it, we do have aggressive positioning though in the mid lane, finding the pull. Looks like they're able to find the pick onto Reacher, but they invested a lot of ultimates.
Yeah, I mean, that's the full combo coming out of Sor. Knock up, pull, and during the while, you saw aggro, he's able to, while the character's in the air, hit the ultimates, and then continue as the pull is coming. That's the full combination coming out from the guys on Sor. Can they do the same to Scylla without those ultimates available?
It's going to be very difficult for ult. Ooh. Not going to find the pull from Brochacha with a rotation from Thor on the side, looking for a potential poke. Now, Kingdom, they have their ultimates available. Four ultimates are down on the side of Sor, and that could be something that Kingdom could potentially exploit, but it looks like Chopper is looking for a gank in the solo.
Yeah, and taking a look towards the Sobek, does have Charge Prey available. Knock him is strong, and there's a Feather Step. Athena's going to go ahead and ultimate over, and that's all Sor want.
And that's all that they're going to need to do, that they force out the Athena ultimate. Thor landed down as well, and they're going to find the pluck onto Uzi, but not enough damage. Scylla makes the rotation, not able to connect the root or the crush as Uzi uses his ultimate away.
Kingdom respond in kind to the right-hand side, but more importantly, Rom gets out of jail. Sor played very well, and they're looking for some capitalization on the left side because of it, and there's two kills going the way of Uzi, but Nyquid able to kill Chapo after the ultimate from Kata, and Kata finds one more as well. So it's a two-for-two exchange. Brownside and Reacher go down in exchange for Uzi and Chapo.
Beautiful pluck back into the crush, allowing it to be that two-for-two trade that Kingdom need to have. Now, unfortunately, there's nothing for them to really take on the side of Sword Jungle. That speed and blue buff aren't responding for another 2 minutes. But moving forward, they might potentially look to... They're not going to push the solo tower. I was thinking that maybe they could find some damage, but they're not going to risk it.
Really want to give credit to Despair. We didn't get to see it because we were focused on the solo lane nonsense. But so Sor make this play. They make the play on the right side, anticipating that the Athena ultimate would come out. And while that's happening, Kiggs and Brochacho are collapsing onto the Rom, expecting the 2v1 gank. But Rom gets out of there, no problem. Sor weren't looking for the kill in the solo lane. They were looking for the Athena ult to isolate Rom and get the kill in the long lane. And it just doesn't happen because Despair, a little bit too slippery.
Nice pull from Chapo. Another knock up. The chain CC is not allowing Reacher to find the dash. Just so much CC, and they finally find the pick. The pull, the knock up, another pull into the Feather Step. There
and
was
the
just
wall.
No time for the Athena to escape.
Last time we saw the combination of aggro, Chapo, and Brochacho. Now we see aggro, Chapo, Brochacho, and unfortunately, Brownside combines. The Athena gets out without that Thor wall, but unfortunately, Kingdom Esports working against themselves right there.
And Brochacho going to get rooted with a crush. The Athena ultimate trying to confirm some damage just out of range. Does find the respawn. I'm a monster.
Nice play.
Going to connect onto Brochacho with Thor in the air. Should find
Beautiful.
The kill as Ram is in the skies.
Brownside picks up one kill after setting it up for the rest. Can't find the second as Kingsmaid gets double tapped. Very well played by a lot of the mechanics on Kingdom. You know, like we said, this team has struggled for the majority of the split, but finally able to find some small victories here. And we're going to walk away. Not too big of a deal.
And we talk about the aggression from Chapo. So there's more aggression in the mid lane. Brownside barely able to escape. We do have the Thunder
too
Crash.
Long.
Despair going to fall down from Chapo. And the ultimate from Raijin trying to find a second one onto Reacher, but he's going to be able to dash away as Neek trying to get off more damage.
So the problem that I'm seeing from Kingdom, because I was just celebrating the mechanics of this team right here. You see Catalyst, he mentioned that this is some of his first time playing competitive mid lane. And already we're seeing some improvement. It's just been about 2 or 3 weeks. And the guys that he surrounded himself with, Despair, we just mentioned a highlight play from him. Brownside doing it as well. Nyquid making it happen. Cat is going to be in some trouble, but it's all about the zoning. So we're taking their second Gold Fury. Brownside in the area, wants to steal it. Can't. Ultimate out of Brochacho off the mark.
Just really unfortunate. And now with this rotation from Nick with the Wrath, there's just no way that Sor should even be close to this positioning. And now Kingdom are going to be the ones being aggressive because members of Sor don't have much mana, and some of them are about half health.
And Chapo, the big chunk of damage on the side of Sor, he's on the wrong side of the map. So Kingdom are the ones with the numbers advantage.
However, the heals from El Brochacho is going to keep the rest of Sor topped off. So if Kingdom overstep, in the longer these engagements last, the more favorable it will be for Sor.
And that's where I was going with it. I was talking about all the positives on the side of Kingdom as far as the individuals are concerned. But when it comes time to team play, these engagements are lasting a little bit too long. That's what we saw on the right side. Sor went for a gank, and the counter gank by Kingdom was perfect. but they stayed there, allowing Soar to take over. Mid lane, Kingdom get a fantastic push, but they stay there, allowing Soar to respond. Now, Kingdom are on the aggressive. Thor's in the air, and he's just going to fall back down.
Soar doing a great job yet again, baiting another ultimate. They baited the Athena ultimate in the solo lane. Now they baited out the Thor ultimate and the ultimate again.
Athena ultimate coming right on down. Can't leash the Gulf Fury just yet, but all the damage on the side of Soar. Catalyst drops the ultimate, but it's just not enough to take the objective just yet. This time, Gulf Fury goes the other way. Kingdom tie it up with the steal, and now Athena gets taken down by Kingsmate.
That's 2-for-1 currently, as the heals does go down for Soar with the pluck onto the Ryzen. Now he's in trouble as the crush connects. That's going to be
aggro.
A 2-for-2. However, Despair put in a really awkward position inside the board cave, and there's nowhere for him to go.
Yeah, as he's doing it, Nikwid now surrounded by three. He's got a little bit of advantage on one of the players, but doesn't want to take it too far. Dashes away to safety, comes right back in, can't find the tail whip on the one that matters, and Uzi's able to just lay waste.
Trying to find the 1v2, not going to find it. The ultimate from a Willish was still online, but it was just a bait. Brownside not, unfortunately, there in time to find the return kill. Yep. So that's going to be a 4-for-2?
Yep. 4-for-2 trade going the way of Soar, despite the fact that Gold Fury is stolen. So Kingdom Esports tie it back up with a good steal and then last a little bit too long there. Nikwid going back in there. Tolly, I mean, you're the one with competitive experience from this. From the outside looking in, it looked like communication breakdown. It looked like Brownside said he was a little bit closer than he actually was. Nikwid tries to extend the engagement to allow Brownside to come in, and he's just too far away.
He could have potentially looked for the pluck onto the Thor, which would have cut the distance as the Thor was traveling anyway.
Right.
Could have potentially followed that up with a stun and a double tap, finding the easy kill. But baiting just 2 seconds, I would say like 1 to 2 seconds too long, and that's the game of Smite. You stay 1 second too long, you sacrifice your life in the process. And now as a result, the Gulf Fury going, even though the Gulf Fury went in the way of Kingdom, or stolen rather by
right.
Kingdom, Soar come on top of the team fight overall.
I mean, take a look at that. Nikwid finds himself as the top damage on the side of Kingdom, even though he's surrounded by gods like Scylla and Thor. I mean, is this Nikwid doing a great job, or is the team dropping the ball?
I would just say, like, they're not in position yet to get their damage online. Kingdom, they have the Scylla, but it's just not that mid to late game Scylla that they need.
Oh, very quick turnaround from Kata. That could have been trouble. Instead, it's trouble for Chapo. Taunted in, barely avoiding the ultimate out of the mid laner. But Kata's going to get smoked out by Aggro from a distance. Number 11 for Aggro as he finds the kill for himself. It's his first in the match, but his team has 11, and they're pushing down the mid lane with the absence of Scylla.
Beautiful play coming out of Aggro, using the ultimate from Raijin to taunt the Scylla closer instead of the damage and to confirm that kill. And now as a result, the members of Soar are grouped up in the mid lane trying to get this tier 1 tower, and that's what they do really well objectively, trying to keep pushing their numbers.
Another wonderful taunt from Reacher, but this time Soar had their plan beforehand. They completely collapse on the support, and that's going to take down one. Can't find the hits is Despair. He's going to get 1 out of 3, whereas Soar get the tower for free. Down it goes, 500 gold in their pockets, 12 doubling Kingdom 6 as far as the kills are concerned. And we see the red squad, the Soar squad, up 3,000 gold.
And this position for Soar, they need to continue this kind of aggression and look for the picks. Looking at the player damage, El Chapo, like we mentioned with a Willish, if a Willish gets online early on, she can snowball.
Yeah.
If she falls behind early online, she can't really get the same sort of things that, let's say, a Thor can do if Thor gets behind.
Mm-hmm.
And looking at the level disparity, level 10 for Brownside, whereas Chapo is 14. And trying to find, you could still play Thor from behind though.
Yeah, and here's the killer for me, Tolly. Brownside is playing a fine game. He's playing a good game. I would even say a good game. He's not playing a poor game. He ulted fantastically to get the team off of the Gold Tree, right? He made a couple of smart plays as well. Just very well played by Brownside, but Chapo is just going above and beyond.
And this is the style that we know from Soar to do. He finds the blind pull through the wall into the mid heartbeats, and now with a continuation from Machacho and Aggro finding another pick.
Yeah, Aggro is going to go ahead and get that kill onto Reacher. Fantastic. Again, it's what we were talking about in the pregame. There's never a situation where Soar are by themselves. If you see a member of Soar, there's going to be three players there. It's never just one.
And it's a very safe initiation on the left side mid hard piece. You're not overextending yourself by just randomly throwing out the Suku and hoping that it'll connect into the pull. And then your teammates are still around, trusting that you'll connect off of it and get the pick.
1v1. We'll be right back. 15 minutes on the clock. Sora's giving it hell. And we'll be back after these messages. Welcome back, folks. Sorry about that brief power outage. Kind of stopped us in our tracks, but it certainly didn't stop Sore. 15 minutes on the clock. We saw one pickoff that I think you guys might have missed, but other than that, it's all been the same old, same old. Tower on the left-hand side just barely hanging on, but it's 15-6, and Sore find themselves up 6,000 gold after one gold fury and a whole mess of successful exchanges.
And they're, objectively, they're just taking everything away from Kingdom. The tier 2 in the mid lane, stripping away the back harpies into the speed buff. We had Uzi proxying the wave between the tier 1 and the tier 2 on the solo lane. So just a great job of farming as a cohesive unit from Sore.
And this is what happens. I mean, Sore, we talk about teams that are emotional and teams that are, you know, play by momentum. Sore, I think, is one of these raw teams where they just feed off of the energy. Kingdom had a fantastic play where they steal the gold fury away from Sore. But Sore might be the team that you don't want to do that against. You basically... Well, you pissed them off, and then Sore took the entire board.
Like poking at a beehive, basically. You're trying to get it off the tree, but once it gets off the tree, it's going to come attacking you, and that's exactly what Sore did, trying to find another pick onto Reacher. However, not enough members are grouped up to chain CC. The beautiful pull from Elbro Chacha. Reacher trying to survive with a sprint, but getting constantly CC, nowhere for him to go.
The blink pull out of Bro Chacho. Sylvanas is a character that has fallen down in the ranks because for a lot of reasons, but one of the reasons is the pull is hard to confirm. You're never sure if it's going to land. Bro Chacho, on the other hand, is blinking and pulling people. That's impressive.
That's the confidence that and the swagger that Bro Chacho and Chapo have together.
And with that confidence, with that swagger, they're able to find a pick and find the objective off of it. So one more time, Sore extend their lead even more so. They're 8K up, Tolly. And like I said after the break, they're not showing a sign of stopping. Bro Chacho doesn't show a sign of missing any of these plucks.
Not at all. Even forcing out the Athena ultimate. Nice feather step coming out of Chapo, allowing Catalyst to disengage with the
and
ultimate
aggro.
From aggro. The fight continues.
Right down the hallway, Aggro pulls all of his nonsense on top of the entire team. Rob's in the air, and the squad's not going to wait for him. Despair does pick up Chapo, but everybody on the bottom. Uzi takes out Despair upon landing, and Nikwid gets a good tail whip off, but that's it, as Aggro is able to secure the kill onto the Sobek as well. So Chapo trades his life, running away to the marksman. That is Despair, but very quickly, Despair and Nikwid fall down.
And with that, Sora going to try to utilize this one-player advantage currently, moving over to the dual lane. That tier 2 tower does stand, and it's going to be easy picking with Uzi trying to zone away Reacher. Reacher doesn't have his ultimate available for
him,
so
Brownside.
As long as Uzi's able to zone him out, this is a free tower.
Yeah, I think Sora, we mentioned it about a week or two ago, where Sora was in general... When he first started, Sora was pretty much the Chapo show. And then Chapo, Aggro, and Bro Chacho really started to solidify very early on in the season as this core that really could not be trifled with. But now these two lanes on the outside, we've seen it for about 2 weeks now. Uzi and Keeksmate have both really started to, I don't even want to say pull their own weight. They pull their own weight and then some. We're seeing MVP Keeksmate last week. Uzi's doing a ton of work in this game right here. And now Sora have gone from this team with three, I don't want to say superstars, but three guys that can win the game in a moment's notice and two role players. And now you've got five dudes that can actually bring it.
And that's what makes a team from good to elite with the plays like
Bang.
That. Chapo just waiting around the corner, picking off Brownside, and the chase is on. Second pick will be onto Reacher. And with this two-player advantage at this stage of the game, that could be Fire Giant if that's the route Sore wants to take.
Kata gets a good pick, and the follow-up from Nikwid. He's going to pull Nikwid right towards him, Chapo, that is. Feather steps out of the ultimate, out of the mid laner, and takes the life of the solo. Well played by the jungler on the side of Sore. Keeksmate cleans up Kata, and there's one man alive on the side of Kingdom, and he's on the right side of the map and the wrong place right now. Mid Phoenix will fall down, and Sore, beneath 20 minutes, take out the Phoenix and take out the Spare.
What a great play from Sore, still finding another pick, recognizing that there was no CC immunity coming out of Despair. instantly, no hesitation from aggro. Sora said, go, and that's exactly what they did. Now getting the mid Phoenix, probably going to transition into the Fire Giant, having the sustain from Elbro Chacho.
Absolutely. I can see Thor backing. Kingdom don't even want to contest this objective. Soar up just too much gold, over 10K in their pockets above their opposition. And, well, they are killing it right now as far as the kills are concerned. 23 above 7, and you can see 11-6 about to turn much higher as the big fire guy falls down to the hands of Soar. That's going to push them even more so in the lead, have the Fire Giant buff. Now Soar will back, spend some gold, and then make their moves for one final push.
You know what's harder than defending against a Fire Siege push?
What's that?
Defending a Fire Siege push with Sylvanas sustain.
Oh, yeah. That's the sustain that comes out of Sylvanas. Because, again, we just don't see this character a lot. Bro, Chacho has always been a guy that has his own god pool, meta be damned, and it is working out very well for Sora this time around.
He's just always in the right position to capitalize off of Chapo's aggression, and it's not even that aggressive. He's just waiting inside the mid-harpy little cove, finding the blind pulls through the wall or waiting for somebody to overstep, instantly capitalizing off of it.
Well, you know what does it for, you know what comes to mind, Tolly, is once upon a time, bro, Chacho was in the PC Pro League, the very first season, on a team that really, unfortunately, could not have any success. Thirst, they had a rotating roster that didn't allow them to do much. And then even going back to High Five, he's played as well. Now, Bro Chacho, for me, his mechanics were always interesting, and I use that as a colloquialism, but his mindset and his gameplay, or his mindset of gameplay, was always on point. And now, a couple of years later, his mechanics have seemed to have caught up, and now we just have a really strong support.
And it's also the synergy that finally the, you know, Chapo and Bro Chacho find these members for their team on the console side of things, and now as a result, they're putting themselves in a really good position. They're still in contention to make the LAN, even though the first game was unfortunate for them. If they close out this game, this will put them at 10-6, and Eager are just above them at 11-4.
And there's a blink forward. Bro Chacho catches a few in the ultimate. One gets pulled by the jungler, and Chapo looking for the life of Reacher. Down he goes. El Sword Chapo on top. Nyquid rotates out on the left-hand side. The Phoenix already down. Right's down. Mid's down. Left. That's the focus of Soar right now. You can see everybody cleared out the waves. They get distracted by Sobek for a moment. Sobek's distracting. But they're going to head right on back to the left side and then expect that final push.
The left side Phoenix getting taken right off the bat. Soar, no more Phoenixes to take, but there is a Titan potentially. And with Fire Giant, with Sylvanas sustained, aggro trying to bait out the Sobek plug, just kind of doing his best impression of Michael Jackson, just moonwalking a little bit.
Just up, down, just waiting for that Sobek plug. You can see it just, hey, we want to turn and burn. But Despair, he's finding the shots. Good taunt from the support, and Catalyst combines with one. I'm a monster. This is a great defensive set coming out from Kingdom. Catafine. Two looking for the third. Is it enough damage? Not quite. And Uzi takes out Kata after a brief reprieve. Well done, but is it enough?
That's the one downfall of Alma Monster. Makes you immobile, and against the Raijin ultimate, that is a huge amount of damage incoming your way, and easily able. Aggro took an advantage of that. Soar still trying to be aggressive, finds Despair, so it is a 2-for-2 currently, and the Titan could take a lot of damage as there will be some fire waves slowly coming in.
There's a pulse. Chapo takes out Nyquid as well. Aggro says, what's up to Brownside? He's gonna fall down. Reacher, the only one alive for Kingdom, and while they had a brief reprieve with a fantastic display from their mid laner, Kingdom looks like they're going to drop this one as well, Tolly. The Titan taking a lot of damage. Four players from Soar still alive, three of which are here, and down goes the Titan. Soar up a slew of gold, a slew of kills, and this time they find themselves in the win column.
Going to put their record at 10-6, right behind Eager at 11-3. And now Kingdom are going to get, they got their second win of the split at 2 and now 16, currently still on the bottom of the pack. Most Wanted and Eager, currently still number 1 and 2.
And Most Wanted and Eager are the teams that we're going to take a look at next. So, for a lot of these teams, everybody is watching these games. For the fans at home, we just want to see some good Smite. So we're going to watch Most Wanted and Eager, number 1 and number 2. For Elevate and their fans, they want to see Eager fail, because that's the way Elevate get into this one. After that, if you're a fan of Soar, well, you're also rooting. Well, you just want to see which way this one goes, because Soar, they're battling with number 1 and number 2.
I just want to work out with Chapo. Honestly, that's my goal. Story, you better make it.
Chapo's been, like we said, Chapo's YouTube game has been on point. Very fun to check that dude out. Want to see him on Twitter, etc. But Chapo, usually the story of the game, this time around, not quite. Many different plays came out pretty much across the whole team. Reacher on the side of Kingdom as well, making it happen. We saw that at the end of the game, and here it is in the beginning.
Yeah, he would just kind of had nowhere to go. Sword just doing a good job collapsing on him. The chain CC, the knockup from Awilish, the knockup from Sylvanas, the Feather Step, as well as the Shibalanki ultimate, which prevented Reacher from escaping. And that was the four ultimates from Sword. And this blink pull from El Brochacho from a sprinted Athena was just so beautifully executed.
And you can see Brochacho in that engagement not going for the pull right away, instead waiting for the dash to come out and then finding the blink pull. And that right there, we were highlighting just how much that Sword, again, they are never too far away from their teammates. You can always depend on Sore to have that sort of buddy system working out where they're always together.
And that's why they have one of the highest kill participations in the SCL currently. Always together, always have so many assists as a unit.
Well done. Going out from the guys on Sore, they're going to find themselves splitting in the middle. Unfortunately, they did have to drop game number one due to the inability to find a team. Different story, though, as we come up next. It's Most Wanted, the number one team, versus Eager, the number two team. You're not going to want to miss this one, but you will. We'll see you then.